thanks for joining us today. So glad to be with you. Trust that you are all well. I'm kind of glad that we have done this series during lockdown, because what we have learned through this series is that the message of the New Testament really has most of its application outside of the church gathering. Thriving is not a Sunday thing. It's a new way of living. Thriving matters most in the place that we spend most of our time. And in our case, that would be in our homes and in the workplace. And it's no wonder then that here towards the end of this little letter in Colossians, Paul takes the time to briefly mention what thriving should look like in our key relationships, in the place where we spend most of our time. Here, take a look. Colossians chapter 3, verse 18. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, and do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong, and there is no favoritism. Masters, provide your slaves with what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. Okay, so now, having read this, we need to take a little time out for some explanation and clarity before moving on. There is something here in this text that should trouble all Christians when they read this, and it is this. In the conversation about how to live as a follower of Jesus, the Apostle Paul speaks about family and then slaves in one breath without skipping a beat. He does not say anything here about the evil of slavery or whether or not the Christians he's writing to should free all their slaves. No, he talks about slavery as a matter of fact. And the reason for this is that it was just a matter of fact. It existed and had existed for a long time. It was simply accepted as part of the way society operated. And so for us to appreciate this section of scripture and be able to draw some kind of application from it, we need to take a few things into consideration. Firstly, slavery was a normal part of life in that part of the world, in that society at that time. In fact, the reason that the conversation about slaves would fit so well into the conversation about families is that slaves were actually, in many situations, part of a household. Good or bad, it was just the way it was. Paul, in this short letter, is not attempting to change the way the world was at that time, but rather to change the way Christians would treat one another in the world that they found themselves in. And then, secondly, because Paul does not seem to condemn slavery here, does not mean that God condones slavery. As you read the New Testament, you will find that if you consistently apply the teaching of Jesus and the apostles, you would come to the conclusion that slavery is wrong and that as a Christian, you could not be part of that practice or anything like it. And then finally, this passage on slaves and masters has some really solid principles that we can and should apply to the regular workplace relationships that we find ourselves in today. What then does thriving look like when it matters most in our home and in our working relationships? The best way to think about how to thrive in these key relationships is to think of one word: submit. Now, as with many things, the connotations attached to any word can change with the generations. So, for example, the word binge. just a few years ago, the word binge had such negative connotations. It was used to describe an unhealthy, uncontrolled, uncouth way of living. It related to eating and drinking in an uncontrolled and unhealthy way. A person who binged was out of control and needed help. Now, you're encouraged to binge watch your favorite TV shows. In fact, as you watch one of these TV shows, you find up in the top corner of your screen the word binge in big letters, as if this was a good thing that you're doing and that you should be engaged in. And what about the word discipline? Such a healthy and productive thing. And yet when you talk today about discipline, especially when it comes to children, people hear the word abuse. We could go on. There are other words, many words that have had changing connotations attached to them over time. And I bet you could add many to this list. The word submission is one of these words. Today, the word submission carries negative connotations. It speaks of losing. In mixed martial arts, when one competitor is in a painful hold that he knows that he cannot get out of, he taps out, he submits, he loses. And if you're talking about submission to the government in society, the connotation is that this is something that you do grudgingly and against your will. And today the word submission might well be attached to the idea of an abusive situation in a relationship. And so with that in mind, we need to understand why there might be some pushback against the passage we're about to look at, and my suggestion that we choose the word submit to shape the key relationships in our lives. But stay with me. I would like to realign your feelings towards this word. Understood the right way, this word speaks of something powerful and good. Let me show you. If there's one thing that is clear to those who have understood the scriptures, it is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that He and the Father are one, that He is equal to the Father and the Spirit in every way. Not only did He say of Himself, "I and the Father are one," He demonstrated this through His miracles and His teaching and by rising from the dead. He had all power and all authority over all things, whether in heaven or on earth. So with that in mind, take a look at this. Philippians chapter 2, verse 1 to 11 says this: "Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made Himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross." Jesus, who was God, submitted. He submitted Himself to the will and the plan of His Father. He became obedient, even obedient to death on a cross. It was the will of the Father that He would die in the place of sinful men to take the payment of our sin. His submission was the greatest act of love the world would ever see. His death for us was a good thing, and it took the will of the Father and the powerful love of the Son to submit to that will for it to happen. At no time did Jesus cease to be the Son of God, equal in every way with the Father, yet He chose to submit to the Father's will. His submission meant redemption for all who would believe. I want to take you to the moment this submission was powerfully expressed in human terms. It's recorded by Matthew here in Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. It says this: "Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, 'My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me.' Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and he prayed, 'My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will.'" Here is the beauty and the power of submission at play. Jesus in his humanity knew the horror of what was about to happen to him. He knows what crucifixion is all about. He knows that in addition to being crucified, that he would be mocked and beaten and then shamed as the sin of the world would be placed upon him in his death. What he faced was beyond our ability to fully comprehend as terrifying. And yet, for it to be done, he needed to submit. And he did. So submission has nothing to do with being a lesser person or inequality. Submission has nothing to do with weakness. Submission has nothing to do with abuse. Submission is about having and using the power you have to take up your role in any given situation and serving the primary purpose of the structure you have aligned yourself with. And for the believer, that is the will of the Father. It was the will of the Father that Jesus willingly submitted. It is the will of the Father that we need to submit. When we do this, God is glorified in us. God was glorified when Jesus did this, and he is glorified in us when we do it. And because God is good and his will is good and pleasing and perfect, when we submit to it, those around us benefit from our submission, just as we benefited from Jesus' submission. And those who we live among and spend our time with will benefit from our submission. So with that said, we're ready to go back and read our verse again. "Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord." Now, let me just say, as a husband, I really love this command. And because my wife is really good at this, it brings pleasure to our home. We never have any conflict over this issue. In fact, we never really think of this as an issue, because it's not. This is just the way it is. We accepted this as the way God has set it up many years ago, and so it's never come up for debate. And because my wife is good in her role, we are all blessed as a family because of it. Not for a second do I or any of our kids think of my wife as inferior or a lesser person because of her submission to me as her husband. In fact, I feel that in so many ways, she's far superior to me. Now, let me just say something about this command. It really only works if the husband is submitting to his role as a husband. The command to husbands is this: husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. We know that there are situations where asking a woman to submit to her husband is not easy, and in some cases, it's not even wise. And this is not because there's a problem with the command or the structure. It's because there's a problem with the husband. He may be a fool. He may be abusive or even evil. Or he may simply be unwilling to operate as the head of the home. And these are unfortunate situations, and they may call for a wife to bypass the husband and seek to do what she can in obedience to Christ in protecting herself or her children. Let me be clear on this. This is not a call for women to suffer under abuse. It is a call for a wife to submit to her role as the wife under the headship of her husband as he leads, as he should. And this should be a pleasure for her, because her husband in turn is submitting to his role as the head of the family. And first and foremost, that means loving his wife, not being harsh with her. It means creating an environment that makes it a pleasure for his wife to submit to him. Now, I like what Paul said when he expanded the same idea when he wrote to the church in Ephesus. He said this: husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. This is the husband that a wife is happy to submit to, one who loves her as Christ loved the church. And we've already seen how he did that. He submitted himself to the will of the Father and died for her. And so as husbands, we need to do the same for our wives. We take up our role as the head of the home by being willing to die for our wives. There is a beautiful picture in this. It is a picture of mutual submission. Wives submitting to their husbands and so lifting him up, empowering them, blessing them. And husbands submitting to the will of the Father, and that is to die for their wives and to lift them up, to better them, to encourage them, to build them up. And wives in submitting to their husbands, and the husbands submitting to the will of the Father and submitting to their wives. And there is this constant willful building up in creating an environment in which both thrive. And by the way, gents, please don't agree and say that you're willing to give up your life for your wife if you're not willing to give up a game of golf for her. And then there's this relationship between parents and children. And the command is simple and clear. Colossians chapter 3 verse 20 says this: children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. So there it is again. Submit. Children, ask me the question. What are we supposed to do? Obey your parents. But in what? How? In everything. But why? Because it pleases the Lord. So there it is again. Submit. Children need to be taught, trained, shown that to submit to their parents is the best way to live. It is how you please the Lord in every way. Obeying, submitting. That is how a child thrives. And here's what's important. This relationship too only really works if the parents are in submission to their role as parents. Paul says, fathers, do not embitter your children or they will become discouraged. How can you ask a child to happily obey if you're constantly discouraging your children? And here's what I've seen happening again and again in our culture right now. Parents who exasperate their children, embitter their children the whole time. And here's how it happens. It happens primarily in two ways. The first is the parent that has things all back to front. It is the child who calls the shots and the parents who obey. It drives me mad, seeing children wanting this and demanding that, and then parents running around desperately obeying them, giving them whatever they want, whenever they want it. The roles have been reversed, and it is no wonder that these children are insecure. They're not ready to manage a family and to be in charge of a family. But if they are being given that role, they do not respect their parents. And they're desperate for that kind of leadership in their lives. And then there are those parents who exasperate their children by constantly demanding the best for them and from them. And it sounds great, doesn't it? But not to the child who colors outside the lines or comes 10th in his grade or loses a race. Parents, if you want to bless your children, then the best thing you can do for them is parent. Fathers, lead. Show them what obedience looks like as you submit to the Father's will. Show them what love looks like as you give up your demands for the good of your wife. Show them what grace looks like as you treat them like your Heavenly Father has treated you. Create an environment for them to grow in whereby obeying you is easy and clearly the way to joy. And then there is this, the relationship between slaves and masters. And again, this is not condoning slavery, but what it does do, it gives us the worst case scenario. And so a fantastic look at guiding principles for thriving in our workplace, in our work relationships that we spend so much time in. And what do we see again? Submission. Chapter 2, verse 22 says, slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, and do it not only when their eye is on you to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is Christ you are serving. And anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong. There is no favoritism. If Paul can ask this of a slave, we can most definitely apply this to ourselves as employees. And let me say this, I think this is the best HR advice I have ever seen. Every young person going into the workplace should read this and make it their own before day one. What a difference it would make. What a difference it would make for us who are employees, working as if we're working for the Lord, doing our best regardless of the mood or the competence of our bosses, because we're not doing it for them. We're doing it for the Lord. It adds such value to any job, actually. And what a difference it would make for our bosses. Having an employee who gladly obeys him and does so consistently with an enthusiasm that makes you wonder what on earth motivates you. And as with husbands and wives and parents and children, the other side of this relationship is that of the master. And if you are in a position of master, of boss, then here is your command, the perspective that you need to adopt. Chapter 4, verse 1. Masters, provide for your slaves what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. You too thrive through submission. As a boss, this is what it looks like. Submit to your heavenly master in heaven. And what he wants from you is to provide what is right and fair for those who work for you. You get an opportunity to thrive as you create an environment that is pleasing to work in. I am so encouraged to see the church thriving in spite of lockdown. Just hearing your stories of how well you're doing and managing the attitudes that you have. Deeply encouraged by that. And I'm not surprised. The gospel is not some academic thing that only has meaning in a church service. It has its best expression in the place where we spend most of our time, at home and at work. So keep it up, church. Thrive. Let's pray together. Father, would you help us to thrive? Father, would you help us to thrive in those areas where we spend most of our time, where the rubber meets the road, where we spend our time with our families in the workplace. Father, this is where our thriving is tested. It is seen. This is where we get to put into practice that which we know is right. This is where we put into practice our faith, our trust, our obedience. Father, would you help us to live in such a way that we submit ultimately to you and then to our role, whether it be in the family as a wife or a husband, or a child or a parent, in the workplace as an employee or a boss. We spend so much time in these relationships. What a great opportunity to be agents of your grace and mercy and love as we do all things in a way that's worthy of the Lord and pleasing to you as we thrive. So we ask for your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. Remember that today is a National Day of Prayer, and I want to encourage you to personally and privately in your homes to take a moment to pray for our country, for our world actually. But pray for our country, for our leaders, that wisdom would prevail, that they would make the right choices. But then pray for all of us, that we would submit. We would gladly submit for the benefit of the whole, and gladly submit because that is what is asked of us by our Heavenly Father and what pleases Him. Have an awesome day.